My name is Bob Harris. I'm a professor of immune therapy within neurological diseases at Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden.
And what is your main research topic?
The main research topic is really trying to understand inflammatory diseases. We do this in a variety of settings. Primarily, it's been within the field of autoimmunity, where we focus on multiple sclerosis. But in recent years, we've also expanded into Alzheimer's disease and brain tumors. So inflammatory diseases of the central nervous system. And what we're interested in doing is learning how the diseases arise, how they're perpetuated, and what we can do to stop those processes. So they're designing novel types of therapy to try and reduce the disease burden, or hopefully to even stop it.
What are actually neuroimmunological diseases?
Immunological diseases, autoimmune diseases at least, are diseases in which the body attacks itself. Usually your immune system is designed to respond to danger, to things coming from the outside, like infections. But sometimes, for reasons we don't understand why, then the body turns on itself and starts to destroy its own tissues. And these are called autoimmune diseases. And what happens in chronic inflammatory diseases is that there's a dysregulation of the regulation. And that means then that the immune system starts to do things which it shouldn't do. So if you have something that goes wrong in your body, then your body should respond and take away whatever it is that's not right. And then that can be either something that happens to your own cells when they become abnormal in the form of cancer, or it could be that you get infected by something, a bacteria that comes into your body that shouldn't be there. So your immune system is there to protect you from these things, but sometimes it loses the instructions not to respond to itself, and so it starts to attack itself. And there are many reasons for this occurring, but really your immune system becomes diseducated and starts behaving in a bad way. And then when it starts to do that, it starts to attack itself, then it can lead to dysfunction in your body. And depending on where the damage is done, then you can either then develop diseases of your brain or your liver or your pancreas or your joints.
And what is your approach to try to find a balance again?
The first thing to try and readjust the balance is to actually prove that there is an imbalance. And so that's one of the things that we can do by studying our animal models and by studying our patient samples to actually try and work out what's happening in the blood of these individuals who actually are sick and how do they differ from people who aren't sick. And that will give us some clues about the immunological processes which are occurring, and that will then give us clues about how we could stop them.
And what's your special approach in your lab? What is your idea?
We have a number of approaches to try and affect the immune therapy. The major focus in the last 5 years has been a novel cell therapy. One of the immune cells which are involved in these chronic inflammatory conditions is a cell called a macrophage. And these are very numerous, they're all over your body and all your tissues, and you have a number of them immature, called monocytes, circulating in your blood, ready for action in case something happens. So when you get an infection in your skin, then there'll be a recruitment of these monocytes to the part of the skin. They'll go from the blood into the tissue, become macrophages, and do what they're supposed to do to kill the infection. The resident cells, which are all over the body, have another role, and we think that that's mostly to keep things in check, the homeostatic functions, so to keep the balance. So there's an interplay between these two cell types. Now the macrophages themselves can have different properties. They can be nasty ones that chew up bacteria. These are pro-inflammatory, and then there are others which calm things down, and they have an anti-inflammatory function. And there should be a balance between these two. It's like a yin-yang. So when you activate one side, then you should have the other side that comes and regulates it. So in chronic inflammatory conditions like multiple sclerosis, then you have an over activity of these pro-inflammatory cells that rip your brain tissue apart, and that's why you get the disease. So our hypothesis is that you have an imbalance in these two populations. People who get these chronic inflammatory conditions are a little bit trigger happy with the pro-inflammatory side, and maybe they're actually insufficient in the down-regulatory side, the anti-inflammatory side. In settings of cancer, for example, in brain tumors, then it's the opposite. The tumor actually is able to survive because it is anti-inflammatory. So in this case, then it's the other side is actually a little bit too active, and you're lacking the pro-inflammatory side. So in each case, in each scenario, then our hypothesis is that if you would give back cells of the right sort, so in autoimmune conditions, anti-inflammatory, in cancer settings, pro-inflammatory cells. So we can take blood from a patient, we can purify these monocytes, make them into macrophages, stimulate them to be pro-inflammatory or anti-inflammatory, and inject them right back into the same patient, hopefully at the site of where the disease is. And that will then restore the balance locally, and then you should halt the disease process.
What is the peculiarity of your research?
One of the peculiarities of the research is that not many people work with these cells, these macrophages that we're working with. They're sort of considered to be the garbage collectors. In the rest of the body, when you have some damage or you need to get rid of something, you get an infection, some bacteria in the skin that get taken care of, the macrophages are the garbage collectors that come up and get rid of all the dead tissue and make things right again. This is why that you have macrophages in every organ in your body. As well as these circulating ones that then can come in high numbers if you really, really need them. They're like soldiers that are pulled onto the battlefield as extra resources. So, but many people don't think then that these cells are so smart, but they're very numerous. And so we actually think that they're a little bit underestimated. And very few people have been working with macrophages until the last 5 years, and then it's been sort of a renaissance in the field. And the abilities of these cells to be multifunctional, more than just the garbage collectors, have actually become a bit more apparent. So now there's a lot of interest actually in what they do, but people are still not really interested in these being able to use them in immunotherapy the way that we are. And it starts to be tested. People have actually started to use our protocol. One of the papers we published where we could show that we could induce anti-inflammatory cells in human cells, which we published in the Scandinavian Journal of Immunology, has been their most downloaded paper in the last couple of years. So there's a lot of interest, and people are actually starting to report using our protocol in their systems and in other disease models that we haven't studied ourselves, and it still works as well. So I think it's coming, and it's not going to become so peculiar, but there are not so many people who think that this is the first cell type to study, and that's why we're a little bit strange.
And why do you think that your approach is better than others?
It's not a question of whether it's better, it's a question of time and money and efficacy. One of the beauties of our theory is that we will use, the hypothesis is that we will use patients' own cells. So there won't be any problem with any rejection when we try and put these back in to the same person. They're their own cells, they're just not doing what they should do. So we give them a little bit of a help along the way to actually turn into the cells, doing the things the right way they should do, and put them back in. And I think that that's a smart approach. I think what we've seen from other immune therapy approaches are that even if they're very successful, and if we take an example of rheumatoid arthritis, where one identified a molecule called TNF, which is one of the signaling components, which is very, very highly expressed in rheumatoid arthritis patients. So they found ways to inhibit this molecule by using antibodies or soluble receptors, which then take it away. The immune system has been developed for hundreds of thousands of years, and suddenly you take part of it away. It's a bit like chopping your foot off. You'd still be able to walk, you'd be able to hobble along, but you won't be able to run, and you won't be able to climb stairs in a good way. It doesn't really make sense to take something away. So I think that our approach is just giving back something that's really a little bit insufficient is a more natural way to actually reset the balance.
What's next?
The next thing with this is then the next thing is really to go into patients. One of the challenges with trying to go from experimental systems to humans is me not being a medical doctor, is that I then have to engage clinicians. So at the moment I need to try and get funding to fund this, and then try and find doctors that are willing to try it. And that's really where I want to go. If I can make life better for just one patient, then I feel that I've done my job as a researcher.
How much do we actually know about ourselves or about how our body functions?
We know a lot about the body functions, and we've learned a tremendous amount about the immune system. But unfortunately, one of the challenges I see is that we're always studying disease. We study people with allergy, we study people with autoimmune disease, we study people with cancer. But we don't actually know too much about healthy people. we study aging even as well, but these are when things start to go wrong. But we actually have relatively little experience of healthy people, and to actually know what's going on in healthy people and how does their immune system actually look. Is it always non-activated, or is it always on the go a little bit, and how is the regulation done there? So I think that we need to actually study health in order to better get a better handle on then what goes wrong when you get disease. But we know a lot, and there are very many therapies that work very well, and lots of new therapies being developed. So the knowledge that we have has actually made tremendous progress.
What do you look forward to now?
What I look forward to, summer holiday. Now, what I look forward to in the research is actually the research community is a global community. And there are lots of smart people out there, a lot smarter people than I am. And what's nice is that we then share our knowledge. And what I look forward to is actually a major breakthrough. It's been a long time since there's been a major breakthrough in medical research. Maybe the last really major significant thing was a smallpox vaccination, and that's way back in the 60s. So it's about time that we actually came with something really revolutionary, and we've had really good advances with sequencing the genome and so on, but most of the advances have been technological. But I think it would be nice if we actually could really nail one disease and eradicate it from the face of the earth.
You got us a prize as a great teacher. What is your role, or how do you see yourself as a professor?
Some people are good at doing research, some people are good at writing, some people are good at talking. I seem to have a talent as a teacher. I realized this quite early on, and I'm heavily involved in all sorts of training and development of training. So it's something I enjoy doing. It's fun to be able to inspire other people to be better in what they're doing, and that's the point of a teacher, whether it's to students, to inspire them in their quest for knowledge, or whether I do a lot of leadership training, especially for PhD supervisors, and to inspire them to actually be good in those roles.
What is good research?
That's a very interesting question. Good beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and so different people will tell it different things. I think good research should be based on sound ethical principles, good critical thinking, and should be interesting. So that for me is what good research is all about. Research is all about searching again. That's where the re comes in. So often good research nowadays is actually going over old research but using new methodologies in order to address these questions. And that can be just as exciting as finding something completely new.
And what is a good researcher?
I'm not sure. You need to ask someone else. No, a good researcher should be somebody that really is interested in asking questions. I need to know. That's what drives me. I'm inquisitive, and I like to be able to think, to be innovative in my thinking, and a lot of what we do doesn't work. So a good researcher needs to actually have the stamina to face failure, because 90% of the time we fail in what we're doing. We ask questions, we pose hypotheses, we test them, and they show not to be true. So we have to go back to the drawing board and start again. So I think a good researcher is actually somebody that doesn't give up, that actually sees the big picture. And for me, it's the patients. If you see people suffering, or you see people dying from the diseases, all the diseases we're interested in studying, there are no cures for. And there are horrible diseases that really affect people. We could have picked something that would be a bit easier to fix, but that's not so interesting for me. I like the challenge of actually doing something that's undoable at the moment, and really to make our efforts to do that. And I think that's also the essence of research, at least in the clinical setting, that one should actually be trying to do something that's going to be of use to patients.
Thank you very much, Bob.
Thank you.